Guys, I'm excited to introduce our special guest this morning. His name is Pastor Alex Bryant. I'm going to let him tell you a little bit about his ministry. I've known him for 20-something years together. We've been through youth ministry and all kinds of adventures, and we started a doctoral program together. We've had just a great opportunity to become better friends, and for the last couple of years, I've really wanted him to be able to share what he does in ministry and the heart of his ministry with you here at Lifestream Church. Number one, his heart for racial reconciliation, and then second, his heart for men's ministry and the way that God wants to use men in the body of Christ. And I think he's got an important message for us today. How many of you would prepare your hearts right now to hear what God has to say to us today through Pastor Alex Bryant? Give him a warm hand as we welcome him.
Praise the Lord. So thanks for allowing me to be here. It's been a great weekend. I see some fellas that were with us yesterday. Who was with us yesterday at Man Up? Yeah. What up? So I do want to say this. Thank you, Pastor Paul. He is a good dude. Man, I've known him for a while. We've been in ministry, just known each other from around the way, and then started our program together. And their family is beautiful. And thank you, Miss Stephanie, for hosting me so well. And just beautiful home and just a great spirit of friendliness and love and peace and stuff. And so, yeah, it's been a fun weekend. You guys have a lovely church. You're doing some great stuff here in the St. Louis area, so that's cool. I was looking around, and I see some of the dudes that were with us yesterday. I also see some freeloaders who tried to crash our party. I'm not going to say her name, but she knows who she is over here to my left. Do you want to just stand up so that all the people know who you are that tried to crash our? No, go ahead. They're looking at you now, white shirt. What's your name? Yeah, she tried to crash our party. We had to kick her out and said, men only. So, no, I'm just teasing. So, I knew she had a good sense of humor. We were messing around yesterday. So, let me just tell you a little bit about who I am and what we do. Is that cool? Yeah. All right, cool. So, I am Alex Bryant, and together with my wife, we are we're under U.S. missions. We are actually chaplains for racial reconciliation. And so, we are the first chaplains for racial reconciliation in the Assemblies of God. We've been Assemblies of God ministers for about 20 years and, you know, pastored at churches. We were in youth ministry, young adult ministry, suburbs, inner city. We didn't care. My wife and I, Angela, that's her. She's real pretty, isn't she? So she's a cutie, you know what I'm saying? So, and I think I'll keep her. We've been married for like 28 years. And you know, we've been married. We've known each other since grade school. And, you know, in high school, you know, she kind of wanted me, you know what I'm saying? And she like asked me, I mean, she did. She chased a brother. She's like, will you marry me? I'm like, fine, I'm tired of running. Yes, I'll marry you. No, I'm just teasing. She's not here. I can say that, you know? So, no, but I'll tell you guys a little bit more why she's not here with us. But yeah, we've been married for 28 years. It'll be 29 in August 5th. And we have 5 kids, 4 boys, and then the little girl. And she is the baby. We're not quitters. We kept going till we had that little princess. And most of the time, you can find me wrapped around her little pinky. And so I'm just going to be real with you. My daughter is spoiled. And I blame my wife for that. That's just the deal. And here's why. Because I'm the one that spoils her, right? I mean, I got one little girl. I have these 4 boys. And, man, boys are a dime a dozen in my house. You know what I'm saying? I will put my foot up their rump. You better keep in line. Boys are disciplined, this and that. That little princess, you know what I'm saying? Like, the rules have changed when it comes to a little girl. And it's embarrassing, but it just is what it is. And she's a little spunky. She's got some you know, little attitude like her mom. So here's my goal. I'm literally going to do what my father-in-law did. I'm going to spoil her and then just let her husband deal with it. That's kind of what my plan. I'd like to say I'm joking, but I'm telling the truth on that one. But we really, truly are blessed. My oldest son, Trey, he just graduated from Mizzou. And then he's working on his master's degree. He's graduating there. His goal is to go to law school. Now, I tell you all that. He's a good-looking brother. You can check me out on my social media. You can see my son, Trey, because if you have a daughter between the ages of 20 and 25, let's talk, you know what I'm saying? Because he's single, and the brother needs some help, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, he's a good-looking dude, but he needs some help, you know what I'm saying? You think I'm joking, but I'm not. If you got a daughter, you want to try to, you know, make a little connection, come to my table, you know, we'll talk. And so that's Trey. People say, is he joking? I am not, okay? So we'll make a connection. Got to help a brother out. And then I have a son, Michael, who's a junior at Evangel. He's with their son, Ben Shepperly, over at Evangel. Now, Ben runs cross country, doesn't he? Yeah. Yeah, he runs. He's like, does all that crazy white people stuff, just running. Yeah, no. Not me. Michael doesn't do that either, but they're at Evangel. He's a worship leader. And then I have a son, Mason, who's a junior in high school, Joshua, who's a freshman, and then Katie. And so I tell you about our family, and you're going to get to know a little bit more about them later on. But, yeah, we just, you know, we just want to make disciples. And so Ange and I, like I said, we've been married for these years. We're called into ministry. But we come from two separate backgrounds. I was born and raised in Fort Pierce, Florida. I was born, grew up a little bit in Fort Pierce, Florida. Now, Fort Pierce, Florida is a very segregated town. I'm just telling you like it is. Like, my family, I literally could go weeks without seeing a white person when I was a kid. And my Aunt Kay, she called y'all crackers. Like, I don't know. Like, I didn't call you that, okay? Don't leave out of this place saying, he called us crackers. No, my Aunt Kay, she would say that, you know? But Fort Pierce was segregated. And, you know, the white people stayed on their side of town, black people stayed on our side of towns, and that's just the way it was. I didn't see a lot of white people. I could go weeks. And then I'm the product of two teenagers who ended up, you know, dropping out of high school. They got pregnant when they were 15. My dad was 15. My mom was 16 when they got pregnant with me. Young kids, you know, not knowing how to be parents. My dad ended up trying to get a job, the only job that he thought he could get as a 15-year-old. He became a street pharmaceutical salesman. And he wasn't very good. And now some of you guys, yeah, he was a drug dealer, okay? I mean, that's just, wasn't very good. So most of my life, like half of my life, he's been in prison. And so I never really had a dad, you know, growing up. One of my earliest memories, I come home from preschool when I'm 4 years old, and all my mom's stuff is gone. Now, we lived in a small house in Fort Pierce, 2-bedroom house. It was my Aunt Kay, her 4 kids, my grandmother Kat, me, my mom, and my Uncle Joey. We all lived in this 2-bedroom house. I come home from preschool once. I'm 4 years old. I can remember this. My mom's stuff is gone. So what had happened was there was a boy that came to Florida for spring break. They frolicked on the beach for a week. He's like, why don't you come back with me to Illinois? And so she did. It was just supposed to be a couple weeks, and that turned into a couple months, turned into a couple years. I didn't see her. So I just felt abandoned. My grandmother was raising me, my Aunt Kay doing the best she could. My earliest memories is that if you can't trust your mom, you can't trust anyone. The devil was trying to take a brother out before he even began. That was what my worldview was for the longest time. I had to deal with that. So moved to Illinois. My mom finally gets another guy who became my father-in-law, and they moved us to Illinois and grew up there and was going to church. My mom knew that she didn't know how to raise me. She was young. She was, you know, wild, fast, and free, running the streets, smoking weed, getting high all the time. And so she would make me go to church, though. She wasn't going. My stepdad wasn't going. But every single Sunday, we lived in the projects. That's, you know, the housing, the government housing. And I'd walk out of the projects, down the street to Mount Calvary Church of God in Christ. Ha! You got to put the ha in it because that's a black church. That's how we do it there. You know what I'm saying? And Mother Coleman, she would greet me at the door and she'd say, hey, baby, Mother Coleman loves you and God loves you and he's got a plan for your life. And then she'd teach me the Sunday school lesson and give me a quarter to memorize the memory verse or something. And, you know, and I'd go back the next Sunday out of the projects down the street to Mount Calvary Church of God in Christ. Ha! Mother Coleman, you got to put the ha out there, you know, bro. The Ella Stallings, ha! You know what I'm saying? Let me hear you guys do that. Go, ha! Yeah. Okay, don't ever do that again. Okay, so. But, you know, I'd go down there, and, you know, you're at church, and Mother Coleman greet me at the door. Baby, Mother Coleman loves you, and God loves you. He's got a plan for your life. And I wasn't getting that at home. My family was dysfunctional. My mom had just married this dude. My stepdad got a little baby sister there. I felt unloved. I felt abandoned. I'm acting out in school. I'm bad, and just all these things. But when I'd go to church, Mother Coleman would greet me at the Sunday school door and give me the biggest old hug and tell me that she loved me and that God loved me and he had a plan for my life. And I started to believe her. And Mother Coleman introduced me to Jesus. I was called into ministry. And man, the rest is history. And I just want to say this. And I love to tell the story about Mother Coleman because I love to honor her. She went to be with Jesus about 6 or 7 years ago. And we left that church. I mean, I was probably 12, 13, 14 years old. And I knew she was around, but I never really had a lot of interaction with her until I was able to go back to the church for a funeral I did there about 15 years ago, and I was able to reconnect with her. And I let her know, I was like, Mother Coleman, like, you told me that you loved me and that God loved me, and he had a plan for my life, and I'm doing it. I was in ministry. I'm traveling all over the United States, been to about 13, 14 different countries telling people about Jesus, and it's because Mother Coleman told me. And I just want to honor all of you who are Sunday school teachers, who are working with these children. You may not even know what's happening, but they get it. They feel it, they're sensing it, and they know it. And so thank you. Keep doing it. Keep volunteering. Amen. Yeah, give yourselves a hand. And so, you know, we're doing ministry. You know, Mother Coleman introduced me to Jesus. My wife and I end up going to Evangel University on a football scholarship. I played ball there, called into ministry. And once, you know, I was in the business world for a couple years because I, you know, just chasing money, power, fame, whatever it was. But the Lord, when he opened up the door for us to go into ministry, my wife and I knew that we were just going to be making disciples. That's what our goal was. We didn't care if it was in the suburbs, the inner city, youth, young adult, adults. We didn't care. We wanted to do what Matthew 28:19 told us, which is to go all over, everywhere, making disciples, not converts, disciples, teaching people what Jesus had to say. And so we found that we were doing that. And like I think it was about 2012, we moved here to St. Louis. We were working, I was running the St. Louis Dream Center, working at Joyce Meyer Ministry. And, you know, a couple years after that, you guys know what happened. Ferguson, Mike Brown, hands up, don't shoot. I was running the Dream Center there. I was the pastor of the church. We had about 600 inner city people, mainly black, and we're dealing with that. You know, we're dealing with the emotions. We're dealing with the anger, the fear, just the uncertainty. And they would ask the police chaplains, they asked us clergy to come on the streets during those 11 days of riots, protests. I don't know what you call them, but I was there. It was rioting. I saw Molotov cocktails being lobbed over my head. That sounds like a riot to me. But I remember they would ask, you know, the police to be on one side because the protesters, the rioters, they were on another side. We'd get out there just before dark, and, you know, they wanted us just to interact with the youth, with the young people. And so it would be about, about this aisleway right here. Police on one side, you know, protesters on the other. We'd walk down the middle just talking with the people. And I remember being there on the streets talking with people, and this is what they tell me. These are young black kids. And they're like, Pastor, we're frustrated. You know, you see what's happening here in the city. You know, they're policing us. They're policing us different than they do in the white, you know, zones. They're like, I go to Kirkwood. You know, I go out to Clayton or West County or whatever. And it's not like this, Pastor. But they're following us. They're watching us. You know, we got the traffic light cameras. You got the Del Mar Divide. You guys know about the Del Mar Divide. You know, one side you got Barnes Jewish Hospital, these $500,000 houses. You go a block over, you start to see the Aldis, the payday loans, the ghetto. And they're like, we're frustrated. And they're like, but, then they would say this, but they're like, but we know that Mike Brown, he probably went after that gun officer. I know that, and somebody would say, man, my cousin was there. Mike Brown was chasing the officer, was charging him, and he didn't have his hands up. He wasn't saying, don't shoot. They're telling me this stuff. These are the young people on the streets, and so I'm hearing this. And I can remember day four. I remember specifically, it was day four. I see Anderson Cooper there, and he's from here to the back wall. And he's talking to the same young people that I'm talking to, and they're quick to tell you their story. They wanted it on TV. They wanted it on camera. And they're telling him the same thing they're telling me. We're frustrated, but we know that Mike Brown didn't have his hands up. He wasn't saying don't shoot. He charged the officer. I would have shot him too. That was the message that these young black kids are saying. And I remember going home that night saying, okay, I'm going to wait and see what, you know, CNN says here. And I get this from Anderson Cooper. I'm Anderson Cooper here on grounds in Ferguson, Missouri, where police have once again shot an unarmed black man who witnesses say had his hands up saying, don't shoot. And that was it. And then day five, day six, day seven, day eight, nine, 10, 11, he never gave the other side. That was the first time that I realized the media is not giving us the full story. I thought they were. I was a black dude. I'm running the St. Louis Dream Center. I have 35 employees, 21 of them are black, 14 of them are white. I'm pastoring a church of 600 mainly inner city people. I'm married to a white woman. I'm raising four biracial kids. I thought the news was giving it to us straight. I realized they weren't. They had an agenda. So then you fast forward 2 years. We end up leaving the Dream Center. We're now pastoring in a church in Kansas City. I was the executive pastor. And you see on the news that a black man ended up shooting and killing five police officers in Dallas, Texas. You guys remember this? And he shot them because he was frustrated that police were killing unarmed black people. And so he took matters into his own hands and he shot these police officers. Now, I'm going to tell you this. I'm very pro-police. I have two cousins that are about my age. One of them's a year older. One of them's 2 years younger. They are police officers in Illinois right now. Actually, my cousin Caleb just retired from serving 25 years on the force. I got a brother-in-law who's white. He was a sheriff's deputy in Bolivar. He just went to the federal medical facility there in Springfield. My uncle, Junior, he was a black police officer on the force in Fort Pierce, Florida, in the 70s, 80s, and into the 90s. And then my Uncle Bill Thorpe was the first black police officer on the force in Macomb, Illinois. I'm very pro-police. I love police. Now, don't get me wrong. I think that there's things that need to be evaluated. I think that police need to be watched, and there are some bad apples. Just like I think that there's some bad doctors. Just like I think there's some bad teachers. Just like I think there's some bad ministers. But you can't throw the baby out with the bathwater. We got to still support, but we have to make sure that there's accountability for those that are bad. I think most people feel the way that I do. Amen? So when these police officers were shot, it did not sit well with me. That was a Thursday. I can remember Friday morning, I'd just taken my oldest son, Trey, to a doctor's appointment. I came home, and my spirit was just heavy. I told my wife, I was like, the Lord's talking to me. I'm going to write some stuff. And I was like, I need you to keep the kids out of my hair. And so that's not hard to do, as you can tell. And so, you know, she did that. And I went downstairs to my desk, and I started writing. And in 10 minutes, the Lord gave me like 26 phrases. And he told me we were to make a video. I come back upstairs in 10 minutes. My wife sees it. And then the Lord started to download stuff to her, too. She's like, oh, yeah, we're going to have the kids come in. We're going to wear red, white, and blue to support America. This is what we're going to do. And we end up making a video that ended up going viral. We put it on Facebook, and to date, it has 50 million views. Now, this is a few years ago, but I'm going to show it to you. This is the message right here.
Who am I? What have I become? Do I stand for something or for money? Who am I? And where's my good girl gone? You know I had a good heart once. What I didn't know I needed. Who am I now that my heart is won? I didn't know I need anyone. But I got to beg, I gotta beg the best I can of it. 'Cause yesterday myself. This should feel right, but something don't. I wanna start again, so I look within.
Man, the Lord is like just using that message. Now, I'll tell you, I've written a lot of sermons. I've preached a lot of sermons, and some of them just haven't been very good. And I know because usually my wife sits like right there, and when it's a bad one, I mean, she's giving me the look. Pastor Paul, you know what I'm talking about? That happens, doesn't it? Stephanie, is it true? Yeah, it happens, because they'll let you know how that is. That was not good. You get home, and she's, I'm not even going to feed you. That was so bad. I'm like, baby. But some of them, man, I'm telling you, I preach some sermons. I'm like, okay, now I know. You know when you got a good one, don't you, Pastor? I mean, like, there's some sermons I preach. I'm like, man, if Jesus was sitting in the audience, he would have been taking notes. You know what I mean? It's like, I know. You, can you say that? I can't. You know what I mean? That's how you feel, okay? But I'll be real with you. Like, this message right here wasn't from me. I heard the Lord speaking to me, and I just wrote down what he said. And the message is this. It's not black versus white. It's not the people versus the police. It's dark versus light. Satan has been trying to use the sin of race and racism to try to distract us, to try to divide us, to try to stop Christians from doing what God's called us to do, which is to go and spread the gospel to all people of all nations and discipling them. But I say no, I'm not going to fall for that. I'm not going to believe the lies of the media, the lies of the politicians that try to keep us segmented and frustrated at each other so that they can more easily control us. They keep black people mad at white people. Brown people are going, what did we do around here? You know, white people are going, I didn't do nothing. And we're all mad. We're all defensive. We're all on our sides. And we're not doing what God's called us to do. Now, here's the reality. I expect non-Christian people to fall for that mess. I really do. I got a lot of black cousins that live in Florida and Georgia, and they just fall for the lies of that the media teach them, that the politicians teach them. I expect it because they don't have Jesus in their heart. But I don't expect you. I don't expect us Christian people who know the truth. And so what we did is we took that video and the Lord gave me this scripture. It's out of 1 John chapter 1, verse 5 through 7. And here's the passage. It says this, "This is the message that we have heard from him and declare to you. God is light. In him there's no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, then we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin." It causes us to have fellowship with one another. Who's this written to? To Christians. Because we're the ones that claim to have fellowship with him, don't we? We're the ones who are living in the light. I expect non-Christians to be frustrated, mad, disappointed, upset. I expect all that. They're confused about it. Because that's what the devil does. He tries to confuse us. He tries to get us at each other's throat. But I don't expect us Christians to do that. And so what we did is we took that video right there. And, I mean, it's just going all over. It's opened up doors. It's taken us places. We're doing stuff with the military. We do stuff in schools. We do stuff in communities. And, then, of course, in churches. There's been doors open for me to go to the inner cities. I'm in St. Louis a few times a year in the inner city with some churches I partner with. I was just here about a month ago. I'm in Chicago. I go there about 4 or 5 times a year. I'm meeting with 18 black pastors in that area. And I'm giving them this resource right here. We took that video and turned it into this book. It's called Let's Start Again. It's a biracial couple's view on race, racial ignorance, and racial insensitivity. The Lord told me, redefine the terms. Because when you label everything as racist, if I think that you're racist, I want to have nothing to do with you. Because that's the emotions that are tied to racism. That's the power of it. It shuts it down. White people are scared to death of being labeled a racist, so you guys aren't saying a lot of stuff. White people are like, I ain't saying nothing. I ain't weighing in on this. I ain't saying nothing. I ain't doing nothing. Because being labeled a racist now is worse than being labeled a pedophile. Let's just be real about it. And white people don't want to deal with that. And so we're quiet. We're the ones who know the truth, but we're the ones being quiet and sitting it out. And who's stepping in to fill the void? Black Lives Matter. And that organization is of the devil. I'm going to say it. It's of the devil. Because think about the three things that they're pushing. Racial equality, which let's give them that and say they, I mean, I'm going to argue if they're doing it well or not, but that's one of their pillars. And then the right for women to choose, which is what? Abortion. We can't get down with that. 60 to 70 million babies have been murdered because of abortion. 30 million of those are black babies. And you know what? It's not even are you pro-life or pro-choice. We let the politicians try to trick us into just choosing. Are you pro-life? Are you pro-choice? This is a theological issue because God is the giver of life, right? And that's what it's about. And so it's a theological issue that culture is talking about, but we've relegated it to the political arena, and then we let them, are you pro-life or pro-choice? Put it on your Facebook. I'm not going to say, I am for life. My parents chose life. I'm thankful they did, and I speak up for life. But see, they want us men, us Christian people, to be quiet about it. You hear stuff like, no uterus, no choice. That's the stupidest thing I ever heard. And these young people are like trumpeting in that, putting on their Facebook, I'm going to always stand up and speak up for life, period. And then, don't even get me started about the racist history of abortion. Margaret Sanger, she was the founder of Planned Parenthood. She was a racist who wanted to exterminate black babies. Don't get me started with that stuff. But so we talk about the difference between racism, racial ignorance, and racial insensitivity. We're redefining the terms so that we can have discussions. Because what's happening is our young people, high school, college age, the Gen Z, Gen X, they want to talk about these issues. And so you got these three issues that Black Lives Matter is pushing. The racial equality or justice, the right for women to choose, and then the LGBTQ community. So when the church isn't talking about these things, when we're not teaching about these things, when we don't give resources to the people, they follow Black Lives Matter. And two of those three things that they're trying to push are poisonous pills that we can't get down with. So we wrote this book, and we go into the inner cities, Kansas City, St. Louis, Chicago, and then Quincy, Illinois. Those are three or four cities that we're working with. I go into prisons. I give this resource to them. I give it away. It costs me about $5. I give it to them. Now, I'm going to give this one away right now, and I do it like this. If you want it, you can just come up and get it. Let's see who's not going to be shy. First one that takes out my hand, it's yours. The young man's trying to beat you to it. Oh, you know what? Hey, listen, my man, I got one for you too, okay? For $15. Come to my table back there. So I'd like to say I'm joking, but I'm not. Somebody needs to buy that young man a book. Here's the way we do it, really, honestly. Man, if you really just can't afford it, I'll give you one. But that's a tool and a resource that we love to give away. You guys help us do that. We are missionary chaplains, and we raise our support. If you want a book, I'd love to get you one. $15 out there. We take cash, charge. You can put it on a debit card. You can, like, you know, go to our website, make a donation, whatever you want to do. We'll get you a book. They're $15. Maybe you can buy one for someone else and help us give some away. That'd be awesome. So that's what we do. So as we got this message, when we've realized that the Lord was opening up doors for this message to go places. We're getting into some jails and doing this message in jails. I've done jail ministry in about 7 different countries, and I wish I had that book to take to them then. I didn't, but we have the resource now, and so we're doing ministry because we need to help speak into these issues that the world is grappling with. So we become commissioned as U.S. missionary chaplains for racial reconciliation. We've been Assemblies of God ministers. My wife and I both have. I've been for about 20 years. She's been for about 5 years. And so now, because of chaplaincy, through the chaplaincy lane, we're able to go into the inner cities. When Derek Chauvin was having his trial, we were up there on the streets in Minneapolis. I spoke at a church. We did a prayer meeting. And we're talking about what true reconciliation is, what true unity is. And so in a lot of these hot, you know, topics, places, I'm able to go in because I'm a chaplain. I go into jails. I can go in the inner city. That gives us a lane to go in. And so I think did we have a photo? Okay, well, there's a photo, I guess, of us, my wife and I, where we become ordained, commissioned as chaplains. And here's the message of our ministry. It's out of 2 Corinthians 5, 18 through 19. Here it is. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and he has committed to us this message of reconciliation. The world needs to hear this message. They don't need to hear the message of, you know, white privilege and white guilt and reparations and all that. I'm not for reparations. Unless you feel guilty and you just want to give me money. Okay, but no, can I say that? Was that too far? That joke was too much? Okay, so sometimes my wife's like, too far. Okay, so I joke about stuff, okay? You got to joke about these things, right? And I tell white people jokes because I'm married to a white lady. I can tell jokes on you guys, okay? That's how I roll. We still good? Nobody's offended yet, right? But this is the deal. It's a message of reconciliation. We believe this is the core tenets, our mission of our ministry is to reconcile people to God, ourselves, and each other through written, spoken, and media content. Now, let me just break that down. We want to reconcile people unto God first. That's salvation. We're ministers. We're pastors. Our heart is to introduce people to Jesus. So all the work that we can do to talk about race or to talk about manhood, all these things, at the end of it, I always come back to the whole purpose of us talking about these things and learning about these things is so that we can know where our identity is, and that is in Christ Jesus. And if you don't have that identity, we want to introduce you to him. That's what it's about. It's about Matthew 18 going and making disciples of all nations. So it's always a reconciliation unto God first and then ourselves. See, that's the discipleship component. A lot of times, there's people that are dealing with deep-rooted stuff and issues that they need to work through. And, you know, Jesus tells us to come to him as we are. He doesn't say, clean yourself up first and then come to me. He says, come as you are. So, you know, my wife and I, our background, and Pastor Paul said this before, we've done, Like, my wife was over a teen challenge facility. I was over a men's facility. We've done ministry with that. We've had people detox in our home. We've done jail ministry, reconciling people back into communities. We've done youth ministry, young adult ministry, inner city. I don't care. It's all about making disciples. We want to meet people where they are and help them grow in their walk with Jesus. And it comes through getting into the Word of God. We're transformed by the renewing of our minds, and that happens through the Word of God. I love songs. When I was growing up, my mom used to make me sing in the choir. Like, listen, you don't argue with the big black mom. And when she says you're going to sing in the choir, you sing in the choir. You know what I'm saying? So my mom really used to tell me, hey, if you're going to play football, you're going to sing in the choir. That's just the way it is. And so, I mean, that's what I had to do until I was a junior in high school. And then she finally said, okay, you can quit if you want to. But by that time, there are too many cute girls in the choir, so I had to keep doing it. You know what I mean? So she knew what she was doing. But I love music. But you know what? You know, unless you're getting scripture and theology and the Word of God in those songs, you're not transformed by that. We're transformed by the renewing of our minds. It's from the Word of God, and we have to get people into God's Word. So reconciling people into God, then ourselves, and then each other. That's the work that we do where we travel and we talk. Last year, I was on the road about 40 weekends out of the year telling people about Jesus. That's what we do. Sometimes I take my kids. Sometimes I take my family. But that's what we're called to do, and we love doing it. And we do it through written, spoken, and media content. We write books. We wrote Let's Start Again. And then we wrote another book called Man Up. I talked with the guys about it yesterday. I'll give you an introduction here in a second. But we do it through written, spoken, and media content. So we write, we speak, and then we do media. This is so cool. This media thing, I never thought I was going to go into it. So one of the kids that was in our college ministry, probably about 15 years ago, he's like, hey, Pastor Alex, you do videos and stuff, and man, you need to do a podcast. I'm like, what's a podcast? I had no idea. And now I am not a technology person. It's not me. Like, when we did that video, there's no editing to that video that went viral. This is what we did. Like, I put my cell phone up on an easel, and I had it right here. We had my kid's boombox. I pushed play on the boombox because I didn't know how to slice music into that. And so we were like, we started to do the video, and I told the kids, hey, everybody better get lined up. Do this right. We're going to go to Chick-fil-A because I'm not editing. And like, halfway through, the phone fell down, and I was like, start all over. And so that video was like on the second take because I don't know anything about media. And then I figured out how to upload it, whatever. But I'm not a tech person. That's so cool. It's so funny that our ministry's with media because I don't do any of it. If you get any media from me, it's from my assistant, Christy. So that's kind of how it works. I go to churches and they're like, hey, now you got a PDF of HPQ, whatever. I'm like, ah, stop. Call Christy. You know what I mean? So, but this is so funny how the Lord works. Now, he's been opening up doors for us to do this podcast. And I talk about issues that culture is grappling with. Some of them are theological. Some of them are political. Some of them are cultural. We talk about societal issues. I've talked about everything from Black Lives Matter to the gender dysphoria, the pronouns. I talk about globalization. I talk about the black community. I talk about whatever comes to my mind. Obviously, we talk about, you know, the Bible and give some sermons on there. But this podcast is just taking off. I didn't even know what it was 5 years ago, and now we got like 220 episodes, and so it's on our website. You go to alexbryant.org, and you can get all this stuff. Now, I am going to invite you at the end of this. I'll be out at my table out there in the lobby, and we have prayer cards, so please come and get one of those. It's information about our ministry. It's prayer cards. We need your prayer because we're going into places. The Lord's opening up doors, and we need, first and foremost, prayer. But we do need support as well. If you want to support us, we are missionary chaplains, and man, all the support, we have our 501c3, it's all tax deductible, and you can get our product as well. But the Lord's opened up a door through this podcast, and then this is a cool thing too. So a couple of years ago, I ended up running for office in our area. Now, I didn't win, but the Lord, I wanted to stand up and speak out for our values. You know, I'm a conservative, and so I ran for office. And but after that, the local political talk show in our town called Wake Up Springfield, they were like, hey, you want to come and fill in, do some guest hosting? I'm like, sure, fine, whatever. And so I started to do that. And after a couple months, they're like, hey, people are liking you, this Pastor Alex thing. I'm on the political talk show, the secular talk show, 93.3 KWTO. It's secular. And I'm Pastor Alex. I'm introducing myself as Pastor Alex. I'm talking about my book, my ministry. And they start getting feedback. And they're like, hey, you want to do it some more? People are liking you. And I'm like, well, I'm traveling too much. I can't. And so they kept coming after me. About 5 or 6 months, they're like, hey, we'd love to have you. Maybe do you want to take over the show? And so finally, you know, we worked it out with my travel schedule and so on and so forth. And so now I am the morning talk show host of Wake Up Springfield, Monday through Friday, 5:30 to 9 a.m. Jesus is being preached on the airway. I'm bringing in pastors all the time. I'm talking about scripture, and the people are loving it. And I'm just like, I'll keep doing it for God's glory, amen? That's crazy how God works. And so, yeah, man, our ministry is about reconciling people unto God, ourselves, and each other through written, spoken, and media content. And here's what the Lord's been telling us. He's been telling us this. He's like, hey, we need to be men and women, and we want to raise up men and women like you who are able to understand what's going on in culture and society and who's able to know what our country needs to do. The Lord took us to 1 Chronicles chapter 1, or 12, verse 32. 1 Chronicles 12, 32. I'm going to read this. So you look at when King David was establishing his throne. You had all these soldiers that were coming and helping him establish his throne. Some were good with the bow, some were good with the arrow, some were good with the sword, the right hand and the left hand. All these strong, valiant warriors. But then it says out here in 1 Chronicles 12, 32, from the tribe of Issachar, men who understood the times and knew what Israel should do, 200 chiefs with their relatives under their command. The Lord's been impressing upon my wife and I that we have to be and raise up men and women of Issachar, people who are able to see just the plan of the enemy that the devil's trying to use and manipulate people through the media and through politicians, who's able to rise above that, who don't engage in the fights on social media, on Facebook, or even in the workplace when people try to get you all stirred up. Men and women who aren't afraid to speak up for the truth. Here's what I've realized. Like, I'm looking in this room, and I see this in every church I go to. There are so many mature, strong men and women of God, people who are reading the Word so much, who are in the Word, who've studied the Word, who are teaching the Word, but you're not engaging in culture. We've acquiesced that social media and the public space is just going to be secular, and hey, we're just content to not engage in it. I'm just asking you, I'm begging you, re-engage. There are people that need to hear the truth that you know, the truth of the Holy Word, that there is one God, that he made two genders, that his intent was for male and female to be together, to have babies, to be fruitful and multiply, to teach them and train those children to study and obey his word. See, that's the stuff that these people need to know. We don't have to fight with them about, all the different cultural things. This is what's happening right now in our culture, in our society. These are theological issues. I put this thing out called the Pastor's Pledge. And I pinpoint 7 issues, and you can see these on our website, 7 cultural issues that society is grappling with right now. Every day, they're talking about it, they're grappling with. They are theological issues that society is talking about, but we have relegated them to the political arena. Number 1, marriage is between a man and a woman. Number 2, God is the giver of life. Number 3, it's a parent's responsibility, right, and duty to teach their children what God has to say. Number 3, we can have racial reconciliation through grace, forgiveness, and peace. There's hope for those caught in addiction. Military and police are a sacred calling. I look at these 7 things, and I give you scripture references. They're theological issues. The Bible talks about them, so we should be too. We shouldn't shy away from them, and we definitely can't relegate them to the world to let Black Lives Matter, Antifa, all these other organizations try to write the narrative. That's not the way God intended it. Amen? So we're raising up men and women of Issachar to speak out on these things. And I've realized that one of the big tactics they're trying to do, that the devil's trying to do, is silence the voice of men in our community. Black men, white men, brown men, it doesn't matter. They've marginalized us in our society. I can remember, I'm old enough to remember, I'm 52. Now I know what some of you guys are thinking. I didn't know you're that old. That's because black don't crack. You know what I'm saying? What's up? But I can remember when they started to introduce the whole battle of the sexes, right? You guys remember that? When it was just fun, like, oh, men versus women, boys versus girls, who's tougher, who's stronger, who's better, whatever. And here's the reality. It started like as a little joke, but now, you know, that has just evolved into they're pitting us against each other. And we're not supposed to be fighting with each other. And here's the reality of it. Women, you can't do everything that a man can do. And I mean that in a rude way. You just can't. Now, that doesn't mean that you're weak, that you're not tough, that you're not brave, that you're not strong. Women have babies. Women have the power to bring forth life. All of us have been given life because of a woman. That is strong. That's powerful. God created you to do that. Now, let's be real. If men had babies, maybe every other guy might have one. You know what I mean? Because I ain't doing it. You know what I'm saying? Like, nah, bro, I let you do that. You know what I'm saying? And so you know, there is power that comes with women. But you can't do everything a man can do. We're bigger. We're faster. We're stronger. We're better at football. That's just like, you know, like what happened to common sense? Like, we got dudes trying to compete in girls' sports and stuff now. Come on, man. Like, why are we not? Where's the common sense at? Don't even get me started on that. But, you know, and here's the thing, too. Men can't do everything a woman can do. But the reality is this. Both men and women can do everything that God says they can do. And that's a truth that the world needs to hear. And so we need godly people that are speaking out. And so what we're trying to do with our ministry is resource you. So they're trying to tell us men to be quiet, and especially white dudes. They want you white dudes just to be quiet, or they're going to label you racist, xenophobic, homophobic. And white dudes are scared to death. I know you guys are. You guys don't want to talk about stuff. Be bold, be brave, be strong, for the Lord God is with you. And so I wrote this book, Man Up. It's a guide to godly masculinity. I'm tired of them telling us that our masculinity is toxic. I realize there's been some mistakes in culture as we went from, you know, the toxic masculinity of the 60s, 70s, where women were marginalized in our society and our culture. And listen, there's probably still needs of work to be done. But we cannot diminish one gender in order to elevate the other gender. And I think Christians need to be the ones speaking out against this. We have to know what God says we can do. And so this book, and I spoke on it yesterday, I'll just give you a quick little overview. All right, I wrote this book for men, but women ask me all the time, will I like it? Will I read it? Yes, you will like it. And yes, you should read it. And most importantly, you should buy it for $15. Here's the deal. Shameless plugs. I give these away as well. I love to give these away in the inner city. I love to give them away in the jails. And you guys make that possible. I mean, this one cost me about $7. And when you buy one, I can basically give one away. I sell them for 15. You know, buy one. If you can give more away, do that. Support the ministry. But we love to give these away. This is for, it's helping and encourage and inspire men. That's why I wrote this book. Now, the scripture that I use in the, well, let me give this away. You know what? Oh, she's up here. Wait. Fight, fight, fight. No, oh, she beat you to it. Listen, I'm going to give you one, okay? For $15. Go to my table. Go to my that never gets old, and I'm being serious. All right, so here's the deal. But here's the scripture that we use and that we weave all throughout that. Now, when you read one of my books, you're going to get the Bible. It's got to be in there. Scripture, that's where the truth is. Pastor Paul and I learned this when we were studying our demon. Well, we knew it all along, but they instilled that in us at AGTS. But here's the message, and this is for everybody, not just men or women. It's from 1 Kings chapter 2, verse 1 through 3. When the time drew near for David to die, he gave a charge to Solomon, his son. I'm about to go the way of all the earth, he said. So be strong, act like a man, and observe what the Lord your God requires. Walk in obedience to him and keep his decrees, his commands, his laws and regulations as written in the law of Moses. Do this so that you may prosper in all you do and wherever you go. Is there anyone here that wants to prosper? I do. We want to live a prosperous life, right? And this scripture is gender neutral. I mean, it's for everyone, male, female, black, white, brown, it doesn't matter. I'd say there's four things we need to do if we want to prosper. That prospering is the fifth thing. Now, I'm going to tell you this. When I started to write this book, and it's a few years in the making, and you'll read the story in it, I thought there were three things we needed to do, and then we'll prosper. But the last 2 years of my life, the Lord has kind of showed me when I finished this book, I reworked it, and now it's ready to be given. But here's the things. Number one, you have to be strong. If you want to prosper before the Lord, you got to be strong. Be strong emotionally, spiritually, physically, intellectually, emotionally. You got to be strong. The Bible tells us that the glory of a young man is his strength. Now, us young dudes, or not us young dudes, but you young dudes, can you know what this is about. Let me look around here and see where my young guys are at. Yeah, some of you guys look like you're young guys. Well, she's pointing to a dude that I would not say is young. Oh, he's your hero? Okay, he can be your hero, but let's leave it at that. But think about this. Ladies, think back to when you were getting together and you guys have been married, you know, now 20, 30 years, and you were courting and you were dating, and that young man comes up and pulls you up, and he's like, hey, baby, opens the door for you, takes you in, and he's wearing his little shirt, his workout shirt or whatever, and it's real small, and you see the muscles, and you come up and touch his arm. What does he do? He flexed it. You know, he's like flexing a gun. And then you, because he knows what you're going to do is you're going to go, ooh, you know, because girls, you know you guys like muscles. That's what it is. That's why we flex. That's why we work out, because the muscles, right? And then you get a little bit older, that muscle ain't there anymore. You know what I'm saying? It's like, ooh, the glory of an old man is his strength, is his wisdom, right? And so, but you know, the deal is this, and I tell people, whether you're young or old, we need to be strong emotionally, mentally, intellectually. Don't ever stop learning and growing. But now here's the biggest thing, and I know this for a fact. Gentlemen, the most attractive type of strength that your woman will ever want to see from you. She will think that you are all that in a bag of chips if she sees you praying and reading God's word. Because a woman wants a man who is spiritually strong, that can lead their family, that she can trust leading her, that is able to deal with all that's coming on, to be the protector, the provider, physically, financially, but most importantly, spiritually. We have to have men that are being strong. And we also need women that are being strong. And so first thing you want to do if you've got to prosper is be strong. The next thing is be observant. He says this in verse 3. It says, observe what the Lord your God requires. Where do we observe what the Lord God requires? The Bible. That's the best place to get it. We have too many people that are trying to understand what God wants by seeking the internet, by seeking Google, by talking to other people, and they're learning bad theology. They're learning different worldviews that do not align with what the Bible teaches us. They don't have a biblical theological worldview. They're in a secular humanism. They're in a scientific naturalism, moral relativism, all these different worldviews and things like that. They're getting stuff like, hey, what's right for you is right for you. What's right for me is right for me. I'm going to speak my truth. That's moral relativism. They're getting stuff like the scientific naturalism. Trust the science. Isn't that what they told us all throughout COVID? Trust the science, except for when it comes to genders. You know, well, doesn't the science say that you either have X or Y chromosomes? Well, don't trust that science. Trust the science we tell you to trust. I mean, but this is what's happening with us there. We're not getting that. So we have to go to the Bible. We have to observe what God says. And he tells us they made them male and female, that men and women are supposed to get together and procreate to bring forth life. God speaks. We just have to observe what he's saying. So be strong, be observant, and then be faithful. That means we have to know what God says. Don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. It does you no good just to read it. The Bible says the person that hears God's voice and then goes away and forgets what it says is like a person who looks in the mirror and forgets what he looks like. You have to know what the Bible says, but then you got to live it out. You got to walk it out. Don't just be hearers of the word, but be doers of the word. Now, again, I thought that this book was going to be finished. I started writing on it 10 years ago. I thought the three points were be strong, be observant, and then you got to be faithful, and I thought then you're going to prosper. A couple years ago, the Lord kind of showed me there's a fourth thing that he wants from that. And it starts with this. I'm going to go back to this. October of 2021, my wife and I move into a new house, and our house a little bit bigger, our bedroom's a little bit bigger, and I have this favorite chair that I love. It's like my sitting chair. And I like it. I used to watch football in it. I mean, I use it for whatever. It's one of those old platform chairs. How many of you guys remember when we had chairs on the platforms that the pastors and stuff used to sit in, the big old ugly lavender ones, or the more ugly the better? Wasn't that how they were, you know, the plaid, you know, lavender and purple and stuff like that, you know, because purple's God's color, I guess. But so I got one of these chairs from one of the churches that we were at that was throwing it away, and I love the chair because it's like it's sturdy. It's wide, and you guys can see I got the wide booty, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, I would show you, but I think that'd be inappropriate for TV. But I need a good chair, and it's got the tall back so that when I'm watching, you know, TV, if I'm watching football and I'm sitting there with it on a Sunday and I got the remote control here, and if I fall asleep like this, my head's not going to just be bobbing. It's just going to go like right here and rest. That way, if one of the kids try to take the remote control, I wake up and pretend like I was watching it all along, you know. So this is my chair. And I've had it for a while. My wife hates it because it's ugly. It's like ratty. It's, you know, the springs are coming up in it. I've literally had to put extra cushion in between, you know, just to keep it there. And my wife's like, we're getting rid of the chair. So we moved into this new house. She's like, it's not coming into our new house. I'm like, baby, I beg to differ. You know what I mean? And so we're fighting over it, right? And so she's like, it's not going. I'm like, we won't put it in the living room, but we can put it downstairs in the basement. She's like, no, it's not coming anywhere in our house. And so I really do feel like the Lord gave me a solution. This is no joke. Like, the Lord speaks to me, and I feel like he said, here's what you do, Alex. Tell your wife that you will buy her a new bedroom set, new bedroom, you get a slip cover that matches, and then if you put that chair in your room, it's going to work. So I was like, okay, I did it, and she went for it. I mean, it's like, so, and so, I'm not, no joke. I mean, the Lord speaks to us. We're listening. So then the Lord told me this, and this is true. He said, Alex, if you put that chair at the foot of your bed, and if you wake up and spend time with me, I'll bless you. I started to do that. I put the chair at the foot of my bed. Sometimes I'd wake up a little bit early. Instead of going off to the bathroom or just getting on, I'd go sit in my chair at the foot of my bed, and I'd start to pray, and the Lord would start to just download stuff to me. Now, I'm going to tell you this. The way that I usually connect with the Lord is through reading his word. I love it. I've always read through the Bible. Like every year, I read through the Bible on our ministry. We have a Facebook group. We read through it every year. I make some comments a couple times a week, and we're just taking people through. This last year, we took 160 people through reading through the Bible in a year. I love it. I love reading the word. But I'll tell you, I've not always been the man of prayer that I need to be or that God wants me to be. I just kind of thought some people are prayer warriors. My mom's one of them, you know, different people. But the Lord was calling me to go deeper in my prayer life. October of 2021. November, December, some big decisions are on the horizon. I made the decision if I was going to run for office or not, and then I get into the race in February of 2022. The Lord starts downloading things to me to say and campaign stuff and this and that, connections. And March, April, everything's going well. And then April 29th hit of 2022. It was a day like no other. It was a Thursday. My wife and I, we get a call from the school to pick up my number 3 son, Mason, just a little bit early, only an hour early. We go to the school, we pick him up. The nurse said, he's just looking a little bit pale. He's got this cough. He'd had a cough for a couple weeks. We didn't think anything of it. We thought it was allergies. And he's like, yeah, he just doesn't feel good. And we pick him up, and he's just tired, sluggish. And we had a busy night that night. My wife's like, hey, I'm gonna take him to the doctor or whatever. Actually, it wasn't a Thursday night. It was a Friday. We picked him up from school a little bit early. She's like, hey, I'm going to take him to the urgent care. I had to go to a men's conference. My son Josh had a play at school. My daughter was doing something. And so Angie takes Mason. At the time, he was 15. She takes him to the urgent care where we live in Nixa, Missouri. She takes him in. And they're like, yeah, he's got a little cough, you know, maybe pneumonia. You might want to go to Springfield to do a chest x-ray. We can't do that here. And so she does that. And I don't know any of this. I'm at the men's conference. And in the arena, I couldn't get any cell phone service. So all of a sudden, I get 3 messages back to back when I went up to use the bathroom. The first one was this: hey, I'm at Cox South, give me a call, it's, you know, pretty urgent. Second one was, hey, where are you, I need you, come to Cox South right away. It's from my wife. And then the third one was from my friend, Dr. Jamie Jones. He ran the Cox South urgent care. He's one of our best friends from our church. And he's like, hey, I think it's benign, that's all I get. So I'm like, what? So I hightail it to the hospital, and when I get there, you know, they see me coming, and Angie and Mason aren't in the room. They're back for more tests. And the doctor, he sees me coming. He waves me to him. He's on the phone in his office. He waves me to him, and he just starts talking to me like I already know everything, what's going on. And he's like, yeah, man, that's so weird that they found that mass in his chest. And then all I heard was wah, 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 wah. I'm like, wait, what? Yeah, man. And then, you know, when we took the test, the white blood cell counts were elevated, and wah, 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 wah. I've done enough hospital visits that I knew what that stuff means. I've been in pastor for a while, and I know about masses and white blood cell counts, but it's my 15-year-old son. I'm like, hold on, what are you talking about? And he's like, and then he can tell that I didn't really know. He's like, you talked to your wife? I'm like, no, I just got these texts. And then Jamie texts. He's like, oh. He kind of puts the phone down even more. He's like, yeah, so they brought your son in. We did the, you know, that. He just seemed normal. Seemed like everything was okay. And you know, we did the chest x-ray, and we found the mass, and I'm like, oh, and I'm like, you know, mass, and he's like, yeah, and I was like, so, you know, I'm like, so you trying to tell me that, and I just couldn't say the word. You're thinking it. I couldn't say it, and he's like, yeah, man, it's like, and it's weird, because the white blood cell counts were elevated, but they're not too far off the chart, so, and I'm like, and he didn't want to say it, and I'm like, so you trying to tell me that my son has, and I can remember, and he's like, yeah, he has, and he didn't want to say it. And finally the word came out. I was like, so you're telling me that Mason has cancer? Yeah. I'm going to tell you, church, my 15-year-old, you get told that. This is the only way I can describe it. I felt like somebody had just, like sized me up and just punched me dead in the gut, because all the wind went out of me. And when the wind went out of me, I felt fear. I felt like anger, frustration. The biggest thing I felt like it was a fraud. because I've done so many hospital visits. I've talked to so many people. I've been there when people's loved ones have passed on, and I'm telling them, trust in the Lord, trust in the Lord. But now it's like, this is my son. He's 15. You're never supposed to hear that a 15-year-old has cancer. The next thing you know, man, they're just moving us around from hospital to hospital. We move from Cox South to Mercy Hospital because they tell us then you can get in the St. Jude's system, and all I hear is wah, 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 because all I knew was St. Jude's is the place where kids go to die. And they're talking about, yeah, we're calling in the doctor. She's the expert. They're calling her in the middle of the night. Now it's 2 a.m. And I'm asking, why is the doctor coming in the middle of the night? Like, is this that serious? And no one's telling you. They're trying to tell you, don't panic, don't worry. We got this under control. But, you know, your anxiety, your fear, doubt, everything's coming in. And I'm walking around the whole time feeling like the biggest fraud in the world. Next thing you know, they send a plane from St. Jude's in Memphis, and they're like, we got to take him down right away. Your wife and him are going to be there for 3.5 months. We got to get this mass shrunk, and want, 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 want. And now it's Saturday, and we bring up our youngest kids to the hospital so they can say goodbye to Mason. And then in the back of your mind, I don't even like to say it, but you're like, is this going to be the last time they see him? And they're crying, and I'm trying to be strong. And we're following the ambulance to the hospital. We go to the airport. They put him on the plane. They fly. And then Josh and Katie, they sit in the back seat. And I'm in the front, and I see him just crying. I hear the sniffling. And I'm like, Lord, I can't do this. And this is what God said. He said, Alex, take your kids home. Get them some food. And if you come and spend time with me in your chair, I'll bless you. So I did. I went to the chair that night, and I sat there. I took my phone. I had a playlist, and I just put it up. You know, like right here, my arms are crossed, and I'm just like praying, I'm crying, and I fell asleep like that. The next day, it's Sunday, I wake up, and God says, Alex, get up and take your kids to church. I was like, God, I can't. I don't want to see people I can't deal with. He said, Alex, take your kids to church, and when you come back here and spend time with me in your chair, I'll bless you. And so I did it. And then that night, it was Sunday night, I'm supposed to get Josh and Katie ready for school, and I don't know nothing about cooking. I don't know how to, you know, do lunches. My wife is like supermom. She, like, makes a sandwich and cuts off the crust. You know what I'm saying? I'm like, I don't even know how to use a knife. There's two types of people that know how to, one knows how to cook and us knows how to eat, and you know which one I am. You know what I'm saying? And I'm just, like, feeling overwhelmed. I'm feeling my mom and sister trying to help me with everything, and I'm like, Lord, I just can't do it. And the Lord said, Alex, put your kids to bed and come and spend time with me in your chair, and I'll bless you. And the next morning, I woke up, and he said, come to your chair, and I'll bless you, and I did. And the next day, I pick him up from school. Come and spend time in your chair, and I'll bless you, and he did. And the next day, come and spend time with me in your chair, and I'll bless you. And the Lord just started to talk to me. And he took me to a level, and he started to tell me, he said, Alex, there's some levels of intimacy with me that you will only understand through suffering. And I know some of you understand that. Some levels of intimacy with God that you will only understand through suffering. And he started to tell me, he said, Alex, I want you to show the world, I want you to teach the world how to suffer with grace. Not that grace that's like the passive kind. I mean, we need that. But the grace, the powerful kind that Paul talks about in Ephesians 1:6, for the praise of his glorious grace, the grace that helps you overcome the world, that helps you overcome the enemy, that helps you overcome and withstand anything that the devil tries to throw at you, that grace that produces endurance. And then he started to tell me, Alex, it's time to finish your book. And the crazy thing is, in the midst of this, a couple weeks after, I completely tear my ACL. I've had surgeries on both my knees 2 times each. I tear my ACL. I was stepping down the stair, and I heard a, it pulls away from the bone 85%. So now I'm laid up in my chair just sitting there, and the Lord's just downloading these things to me. And here's what he said. He gave me that fourth part of the book. It's time for us men, and all of us, really, but men. And I didn't catch this in this passage. And he says, you know, obey the Lord's, you know, commands, his laws and decrees. And then he says, and keep obeying. Keep walking. Keep doing it. It's like, that's it. We need more men, women who are willing to keep on doing it to show that endurance, because that endurance, it produces something that when people see us and they know us, they're like, you've been through some things, haven't you? But if you did it, I can do it. Greater is he who's in me than he who's in the world. I can do all things through Christ because he gives me his strength. I'm at the end of Alex. Alex ran out of strength a long time ago. I really did. I'm going to tell you one of the hardest things for me in my ministry right now is that I have to travel without my wife. She's my best friend. We started this thing together. She's my partner. She's a better speaker than I am. And I hate doing it without her. I hate going to hotels lonely at night and knowing that my wife is back there. But I'm doing it because God's called me to do this, because people need to hear the message of reconciliation. And I'm going to tell you this, church, I'm all in. I need you to be all in. I need you to pray for us. I need you to support us, and I need you to learn so that you can do, you can talk, you can minister, you can share these messages, because the world needs to hear. It's time for us to man up. It's time for us to talk to people about what reconciliation is, to reconcile people to God, ourselves, and each other. And it's all because of what Jesus does. Amen? Hey, let me say a prayer for you. Amen? Will you bow your heads and close your eyes? I want to say a prayer for you.